Assalamualaikum and welcome to Neurology Made Easy. So after a long time I am making this video. So today's topic is requested by one of the member of Neurology Made Easy family. So I'm making this video on epilepsy syndromes. I have made these notes myself and I think so you will also find them easy to remember. So first of all, I have made these columns. First of all, that's syndrome. Then we have the clinical features. Then we have EEG findings, other important details, and if there's something more important to discuss. So firstly, I will tell you about benign familial neonatal epilepsy. So the clinical features of this is that the baby is full term and normal at birth. The seizures start at second or third day of life in 80% of the cases. Typically, the seizures are clonic and often preceded by tonic movements. Often these are unilateral. So we have a full term baby, normal at birth, and seizures start at the second or third day of life in 80% of the patients. Typically clonic and followed by tonic, and they are often unilateral. The EEG findings are interrectal EEG is usually normal. That is the period in which the patient is not seizing. So this EEG is normal. Other important details are that it is an autosomal dominant condition and there is voltage-gated potassium channel mutation. This usually remits within 2 to 6 months and there is slight increased risk of later epilepsy. So usually it's benign, but there is slight risk of increased epilepsy in later life. The next we have early myoclonic encephalopathy. So in this condition, neonates have severe seizures and there's no gender predominance. There's encephalopathy, erratic myoclonic seizures that last for a few hours, and then focal clonic seizures. So there are myoclonic seizures and then there are focal clonic seizures. Repetitive tonic spasm may develop later in the course. So we have different types of seizures. First of all, the seizures are severe and it can happen in both male and female gender, and the seizures are myoclonic, clonic, tonic. So because 3 and 4 months of age, between 3 and 4 months of age, the tonic seizures can also develop after resolution of other types of seizures. So it means that all of these seizures do not come at once. First of all, we have myoclonic for a few hours, then we have focal clonic seizures, and after 3 to 4 months, we have, after the resolution of other types of seizures, we have tonic spasm, repetitive tonic spasm. In EEG, we find that there is burst suppression may be present, and that may be present only in sleep. It can occur in all sleep wake stages. Also, bursts are usually short, 1 to 3 seconds, and the period of suppression are relatively long, 2 to 10 seconds. There is sometimes no associated EEG pattern when myoclonus is present. So, you know, in myoclonus, there's no specific pattern on the EEG. But EEG seizures are recorded when there is focal clonic or tonic seizures. So, what we have learned, that there is burst suppression. In burst suppression, there is a short burst, there are short bursts, 1 to 3 seconds, and then there is period of suppression, and that is relatively long, 2 to 10 seconds. And in myoclonic seizures, there are no specific pattern. While in focal clonic and tonic seizure, you will find a pattern. So other important disease is that later in the disease course, in early infancy, EEG evolves to a modified hypsarrhythmic pattern or to multifocal spikes and sharp waves. So this EEG evolves into hypsarrhythmia pattern or to multifocal spikes and sharp waves. If you do not understand these terms of burst suppression and hypsarrhythmia, I will discuss later in another video with the pictures of these. Yeah, what is burst suppression? How can we identify hypsarrhythmia? So mention in the comments if you do not understand its words. If you do, or if you can find the any other video in which there is recording of EEG or in the books, you can find that it's good. Otherwise, I'll make a video. Because of copyrights, I don't take material from other videos, like EEG videos, but I can draw these for you if you want. Okay. Infants do not develop neurologically and tend not to acquire any developmental milestones. So these infants do not develop neurologically and they tend not to acquire any developmental milestones. Approximately 50% of affected infants die, most within the first year of life. So the next important detail is that it is associated with inborn errors of metabolism, including non-ketotic hyperglycemia, glycinemia, D-glyceric acidemia, methylmalonic acidemia, hyperammonemia due to carbamyl phosphate synthetase, pyridoxin deficiency, propionic acidemia, molybdenum cofactor deficiency, sulfite oxidase deficiency, Menkes disease, Zellweger syndrome. So you see, for example, there is pyridoxin deficiency and you replace pyridoxin, or there is a deficiency of any cofactor and you can replace, if possible, you can replace that and patient may get better. But the prognosis is not so good. You see, 50% of the affected infants die, mostly within the first year of life. So it is a severe form of epilepsy and it is early myoclonic encephalopathy. So next we go to the next we have benign neonatal convulsions, benign idiopathic neonatal seizures, inko where we also call them fifth day fits. So I kept these benign. First benign, that is benign familial neonatal epilepsy and benign neonatal convulsions apart, like on first and third position, so that you don't confuse them. I put myoclonic encephalopathy in between. So this is benign neonatal convulsions. So in the first one, you see it was familial, benign familial neonatal epilepsy, autosomal dominant. But here we have benign neonatal convulsion and they are idiopathic. Not familial, and they are called fifth day fits. Most frequent seizures type is unifocal clonic, sometimes associated apnea is also there. Seizure lasts for 1 to 3 minutes and most are self-limited. Some do evolve into seizures that are prolonged, usually reoccur during a period of 24 to 48 hours. So they are unilateral focal seizures. And 1 to 3 minutes they last. Mostly they are self-limited and some evolve into seizures that are prolonged and reoccur during a period of 24 to 48 hours. I repeat because I think so maybe I speak a bit fast and someone does not understand, so I repeat, and it's always good to revise. Okay. Background can be normal or abnormal with excessive discontinuity or and multifocal negative sharp waves. This pattern is called theta point to alternance. It is characterized by non-reactive rhythmic slow activity, discontinuity, interhemispheric asynchrony, and multifocal sharp waves. So, background can be normal or abnormal with excessive discontinuity and multifocal sharp negative waves. This is a specific name for this pattern, theta point to alternate, and it is characterized by non-reactive rhythmic slow activity, discontinuity, interhemispheric asynchrony. That is, in one hemisphere there is the waves do not match in both the hemispheres, and they are multifocal sharp waves. Next important details, etiology is unknown. Proposed zinc deficiency or rotavirus or de novo mutations in PCNQ2 gene, but it's not definite that these are the causes, but it's just proposed. Occur in term or late preterm infants, uneventful pregnancy, labor and delivery, with no family history of seizures and with normal neurological examination between seizures. This outcome is good. So proposed diagnostic criteria include the following: Apgar score greater than 7 at 1 minute. Typical interval between birth and seizure onset is 4 to 6 days. So average 5 days, so it's called 5th day seizure. Normal neurological examination before seizure onset and during the interictal periods, this normal examination. Normal laboratory and imaging findings, such as metabolic studies, neuroimaging, CSF analysis, no family history of neonatal seizures or postneonatal epilepsy. Treatment, sometimes treatment is required and sometimes treatment is not required in this type of epilepsy. So the next is Otahara. Otahara epilepsy, but we will discuss in the next video, because I think so it is enough for today that we have discussed three of the syndromes: benign familial neonatal epilepsy, early myoclonic encephalopathy, and benign neonatal convulsions. So in the next video, maybe today or tomorrow or in the coming week, I will tell you more about the syndrome. I'll just give you an overview. We have Otahara, we have benign familial infantile epilepsy. Then from neonate, we will move to the infantile epilepsy. Genetic epilepsy with febrile seizure plus Dravet syndrome, myoclonic epilepsy of infancy. Then we have West syndrome, LGS. Then we have Landau-Kleffner syndrome. Then we have Absence seizure, autosomal dominant nocturnal frontal lobe epilepsy, Duse's syndrome, Aicardi syndrome, Beck's. This name is difficult, but Panayotopoulos syndrome. I always find difficult to pronounce it. Early onset childhood occipital epilepsy, Gestalt type or late onset childhood occipital epilepsy, JME, that is juvenile myoclonic epilepsy. Then I have mentioned some of the abbreviations I have used. Then I have described West syndrome, temporal seizures. So it took me a lot of time and effort to make these notes, but I think so, because in the book I find that we read in, from the book, but in the end when we have read 5, 6, or 10 pages, we find that it's all mixed up and we don't remember exactly all the points. That's why I have made these points at least we should remember. So, okay, what is the, what are the clinical features, ED finding, and important details. Okay, so I hope you like this video, and in the coming future I'm also going to make the case series, more cases, and so see you in the next video. Take care, bye. Like, share, and subscribe if you have not done it.